We gather here today in the mood of repentance, which means we know we have to exchange belief systems. Absolutely we do. How do we do that? It's a continuity fear we have, a continuity problem. Move our comfort zone bit by bit by bit by bit towards the truth of what we are. So, we always have this as our context. Now, the world may ask you, explain, explain, explain. Let's say that you have reached realization and realize that all you need to do is hold on to realization and that fixes all problems. That is the fix for all problems. Just hold on to truth. Holding on to truth is the fix for all lies, isn't it? Nothing else need be done. So you're asked this question, and the answer to that is, the words are there to clarify. The words are there, but the hearing has to be there. The hearing has to be there. That's primary. So what everyone has to do is work on the hearing. How to hear. How to hear. We must become experts in hearing the truth, more and more and more practice. So I've spent a lifetime of intense practice on hearing. That's why I'm able to hear as much as I do. And I'm still working on it, of course, but I am able to get to some very, very, very helpful clarifications. But again, this is lost on those who are not able to hear. And hearing, working on your hearing is a daily, daily, daily effort. It's not just like you take a seminar and you've got it. No, it's an everyday effort, moving your comfort zone gradually. There is no intellectual cure for a continuity problem. Keep this in mind. There is no intellectual, conceptual, explanative, that's not a word, explanation for, that will cure the continuity problem. None whatsoever. Let's say you come upon a beautiful vista or something that's just so incredibly beautiful. You just stop in your tracks and say, wow, I can't go any closer. It's too beautiful. I've got to stop right here. That's a continuity fear. So what do? You sit there and say, well, that I shouldn't be afraid because that's just a vista and it's beautiful. I know these words, how to describe it. So, okay. No, you're still like, oh, I can't move. What happens then? You start making excuses like, well, I got something better I need to do. Well, you know, this is not what I should be doing. You start rationalizing. That's how it happens when you approach it overly intellectually. You start rationalizing your avoidance of it. So what you need to do is you sit down and say, okay, I'm sitting here. Why am I sitting here? Is the first question. You say, why am I sitting here not doing anything? Oh, I have a severe continuity problem of this perfect beauty that I'm seeing. It's too much for me. So that is why I am sitting here. So identify what's going on with you. This is the key. What's going on with me? Spiritual discernment. I have a continuity problem. I'm afraid of perfection. And then you say, okay, I'm sitting here. Why? In order to get used to where I am right now so it's not too much for me. And then the next thing to do, I know what the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to shuffle forward a little bit and get a little closer. That's what I'm going to do. So I know why I'm sitting here. I know what the next thing I'm going to do is. All right? So you're not lost anymore. See, the repentant are not lost. They've identified their situation and what to do about it. This world, the way it is now, I went out today and I went to Home Depot, Bed Bath & Beyond, and you know, out, I was like, oh, you know, shoppers, new merchandise. I was like, wow. And just looking at it, and it hit me that everyone looks, seems so happy and so healthy and so bustling, and it's just like, wow, no problem. You know, this is, life is great. And I realized this world is very good at producing citizens, but very bad at producing saints. So instead of producing saints, which is what we're supposed to do, this world, we're producing citizens. So I was surrounded by all these well-adjusted, happy citizens, but not a saint to be found among them. The purpose of being here, the real purpose that we must accept, is to be saints, not good citizens. Okay. Now the two are not mutually exclusive. You can be a good citizen as well. But the path of sainthood doesn't emphasize a good, being a good citizen. It's not brought up to some ideal. You can be a little ragged. So this world is obsessed with producing good citizens. And this is a new world order. Their obsession is, let's have a whole globe of good citizens. Carlson, it'll be a whole globe of good citizens and no saints. This is their paradise, they think, their paradise. Now, why do we find ourselves in this situation? Well, ultimately, we're spirit and we try to be greater than God. We try to change reality. We try to change reality. And this is why we actually have this situation that we're in. But why do we get pulled into another identification with gross form here in this realm here is gross conditioned existence. There are other subtler realms of also conditioned existence. But finding ourselves down here at the bottom of the pit with a this body of flesh is terrible. I've always asked myself, what is it that tricked me into coming back here? Well, it's a combination of factors. But I identified a couple today. One in particular was just mind-blowing. Now, previous life and maybe lives before that too, I was focused on music. And I was super musician, super musical. Life was music, period. I viewed the world as music. And for me, that's the purpose for this world was music. So I was 100% believing that if everybody in the world could just listen to great music, it would be paradise. You know, this is I had a whole belief system, very intense belief system. I was an evangelist of music, absolutely an evangelist of music, very much totally believed in music. Now, with spiritual vision and foresight as is possible in the after realms, after we pass from here, subtler realms of conditioned existence, it is possible to see the future in this world and see the trends, what's going to happen here. And what is likely happened is I saw what has happened now with music, where we literally have this, everybody has access to this vast, vast, vast library of music, right? With the internet and the MP3 players in the various ways. And we could all set up our own playlists, right? We can set up unlimited playlists, unlimited songs, have music going constantly, exactly custom made. For instance, YouTube is now auto-generating channels. I just looked up a song, a George Jones song, and there's this channel said George Jones topic, and my God, it's just got like every song he's ever sang, and it's auto-generated by YouTube. And it's just like, well, all these songs that were not on the internet of his songs, now they're there. I said, what in the world's going on here? So they're making available just the whole library of music in the world available to everybody. Now, for my previous belief system, this to me would be paradise. So I must have seen what's going to happen in this world and thought, oh, I can't miss this. This is paradise. This is like the ultimate. The ultimate. I mean, the YouTube, you know, is just amazing with music. And of course, they have all these other Amazon, Google, Apple, whatever store, music, right? Where you can just get any kind of genre you want. And at YouTube, you get all this like old classic country stuff, which I enjoy. All sorts of older music too, right? It's just like we have this huge global library of music now available. And we can custom make our playlists, which I've done with this on my channel, YouTube channel, the Inspirational Songs playlist. And this is just wow. Musically, this is just wow. You think it's like music nirvana. Or music heaven. It's the ultimate. Well, I thought today, oh my gosh, that probably is what tipped the balance to coming back into this world. Big mistake. Because with all this music and all the vehicles, for me it's just like, Who cares? You know, all my problems, all my existential spiritual problems still are still exist. Music hasn't done anything for it. It doesn't touch it. And another pull for a lot of people is, well, for instance, fashion, the fashionistas, the capacity to buy just about anything you want as far as fashion goes, whether it be in antique stores, whether it be in thrift stores, whether it be on eBay, or you could go in there and you could just locate, you know, whatever gems of fashion and decor and stuff. If you're a decor junkie, designer, you're an interior designer, a fashionista, anything like this, you know, my gosh, you know, someone has a costume somewhere and across the world somewhere. It's on eBay. You could get it ordered. It's at your door, you know, a week or so. And so, just the parade of people, you know, just the beautiful people, the healthy, beautiful bodies, the way they dress and everything. It's just like, if you were into that, it would seem like, you know, paradise, fashionista paradise here right now. So you combine that with the music. Combine that with the food. I mean, it's a paradise for foodies right now, isn't it? Material goods, you know, just a whole ball of wax. It seems like a paradise, actually. It would seem that way, looking at it from the subtler realms. And so I must have been tempted to come back here, seeing that. But especially the music, that would have just definitely have hooked me. It's like we're like fish in this realm is trying to hook us, has these lures that look real nice and tempting, and you bite the lure and you get hooked and you get pulled down here, and then you're heir to all the terribleness of this realm. In spite of all this music available, I've had nothing but misery. Music doesn't solve it at all. And I say, oh man, what a bad mistake that is. What a terrible mistake. And if you're into people, beautiful people, the people, cultures now are all mixing all over the world. So you go around and you see people, every kind of person from every different country, all the different varieties of looks, you know. So if you're into how people look, it's like a paradise for that too. If you're into kind of weirdness, the tattoos everywhere, just everybody kind of, you know, stepping out with you know, statements of presentation statements, saying, you know, same thing. There's a lot of stuff, a lot of lures here in this realm that could hook you and bring you back into this realm. But I put up the best country gospel, Southern gospel song list I can find, and after listening to it, you know, I said, I still feel the same. Doesn't do anything. Doesn't cure what ails. Doesn't cure. Doesn't free me from death. From the delusion of death, delusion of aging, delusion of tiredness, delusion of sickness. Doesn't. I'm not in bliss. I'm not in steady, permanent bliss because of any of that. And if you're just into resorts and golf courses, my gosh, they're just resorts and golf courses all over the world, you know. It just, there's so many things. It's like a material paradise here right now. This is what has hooked us. This is what has hooked us. Now, we may not admit that and say, no, I'm coming back just to help people. You know, well, not. If you're really clear about that, you would not fall into delusion. As I've said, simply holding on to truth is all anyone needs to do. That's it. So, truth could be spoken and talked about and pointed to, but the hearing is what's important. And most people have never practiced hearing at all in their lives. They may have done plenty of action and this and that, but hearing the truth, has anyone ever practiced hearing the truth about this world, about this situation, about our identity, about existence, which, by the way, doesn't exist. Existence doesn't exist. Can you hear this without getting trapped in level confusion? For instance, saying, wait a minute, You just said existence doesn't exist, but you're referencing existence, saying that it doesn't exist, and that's dualistic. That's contradictory. But that's level confusion. Looking at it that way. So can you just easily hear your existence doesn't exist? Existence doesn't exist. Who can just hear that and get it? So I'm reading the words of Jesus in Journey Beyond Words. These are the words of Jesus. I'm absolutely convinced of this. Who's doing that? Who's really doing that? More than that, who's hearing it, actually hearing it? Who's deepening the hearing? You have to deepen the hearing, deepen the hearing, deepen the hearing, deepen the hearing. Keep deepening the hearing of it. And Jesus says, look, I tell you that when I look at you, I don't see you as a body. I see you as this beautiful, shimmering, glimmering, golden light of freedom and joy and creativity and invulnerability and perfection and truth. And I see you as this endless, eternal, beautiful, glowing, shimmering light. Just, this is how I see you. This is the testimony of Jesus, the testimony of one who has set down forever the effort to try and die. See, he set down the effort to try and die, knowing that spirit cannot die. So he tells us to try and see everyone in the world this way, not as a body. Keep in mind that any happiness that comes via the body, you're imagining your own death, actually. You're imagining your own death, because surely the source of that happiness will pass away, you see. So bliss does not come in relation to any body or any special relationship between bodies at all. Bliss is inherent in the very nature of reality, the complete freedom. And keep in mind the clear light, which just seems to be voidness, this beautiful, perfect voidness, emptiness, as it were, is actually the form of everything, the form of all, the form of all. This is what we are. This is our awareness of the clear light, the form of everything. And so all of reality, the way that it is blissful, inherently blissful, without doing anything to make it blissful. And this is our inheritance. This is what we are. And so deepening our hearing of this is the spiritual path. Spiritual path is simply deepening our hearing of the good news. Deepening our hearing of the good news. That's all it is. And so Jesus says, see everyone as light, as joy, as peace, as freedom. Don't see them as bodies. Don't see them as bodies. Give freedom to them. The freedom that you give to everyone is the same freedom that you will experience. This according to Jesus. Whatever you want to experience, release that experience to everyone and say, well, everyone is free to experience this. I don't hold anybody away from this experiencing. I don't bind anyone at all, to anything at all. This is called freeing from your values. That no matter what anyone does in this world, Jesus says that they're just play acting, masquerading, pretending a role. He says none of those roles have anything to do with what we are. They don't change what we are in the slightest bit. Therefore, don't value any of these roles. Have fun in your little, play acting, he says. That's fine. But realize it has no effect on what you are. It has no effect. We're just play acting here. And so he says, see everyone in that way. I feel like I'm going to get a call here pretty soon. We'll see. See everyone in that way, and you release them from any particular appearance or role whatsoever. Then you free yourself, and then he says, then you will experience bliss. You will experience the bliss. And again, all this teaching is hair on fire teaching, because we have a timetable, calendar, so to speak. where we need to rise. If our hearing's not mature by the middle of July, I believe, 2016, we will be too far down the rabbit hole to really be able to discern properly what in the heck, what's going on, what do I believe? It's like, wow, wait a minute. They're talking about a birth of a new race, a genderless race of people and bodies, and that's supposed to be the answer or something like that. But if you know what Jesus' words is, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. The whole thing is to realize, nobody's a body. So this whole nonsense about birthing a new transgender race, what is that? It's still based on bodies and forms. That's just going in circles. That's not solving anything. And yet this is part of this big push about that we're giving birth to a new age, a new race of humans, getting ready for hybrids. And I spoke about the really big business alliance that's in place in this world now. I think a lot of you are waking up to this, actually. It's an alliance between the big business of this world, the really big business of this world, the elite in the banking and all the multinationals and politics, so really big business. The alliance with that, with really big business outside of this world, those who are very skilled for sure in what they do. And this alliance is what is transforming this culture here in this world. And they're promising us all golden age, under their leadership. There's nothing spiritual at all in what they're talking about. It's all superficial. It's all dualistic. It's all delusional. So we need to be able to hear. We need to have the ability to hear the words of the saints, the sages, the gurus, the saviors, the teachers, the masters, etc. The imams, the prophets, the enlightened ones, okay, the rabbis, the ones who really know. We need to be able to hear what they're saying, truly hear. Our ability has to be very strong to hear this, so we don't get lost in this new world order, new age, new world order nonsense. So, everyone could go out and dress as a woman or dress as a man and accessorize, and we'll want to wear a dress today, we'll wear a dress, and we'll have a purse, and we'll be able to say, hey, I can have a Louis Vuitton bag too. I'm going to go out with my Louis Vuitton and my pumps, and a wig, and have a beard too, and everyone say, oh yeah, this is great, this is it, this is paradise, listening to all our music, right, and eating all our food, and we can have it all. We can be male, female, eat all the food, dress all the accessories, dressing, music, material goods, and this is it. This is what they're telling us, and people are all spellbound to it. Now, the Holy Spirit knew all about this and put me through a whole phase of training, very difficult training, where I sort of went through all of that and said, how does this feel? And then after a while I said, blah, finally just like blah, blah. So I've already been through all that, the whole new world order, new thing, ahead of time, fire break the whole thing, ahead of time. But this is what's happening. This is, in the feminization of men, it's more than a feminization, it is saying, hey, you don't need spiritual discernment. Look at this paradise we're getting. You can have it all. You can have it all. The men can dress like women. The women can dress like men. It's all still bodies, 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 bodies. Determinism, determinism, determinism. Okay? That's all false, false, false. I am not a body. No one is a body. Existence has never even existed. Existence isn't even a body. This world is not even a world. Okay, this is the truth we need to hear, and we're not hearing that, are we, from all of these folks who are bringing in this new world order. So we can all be just these, gluttonous consumer clowns, basically, and think we're so cool, fashionistas, you know, fashionistas with just all this music going on and food eating and hanging out and shopping in Ginza or something, you know, with all the cool LED stuff, you know, and the beautiful materialistic forms, glittering chandeliers, and, you know, clothes. I mean, yeah. I've been through that. I used to live in Tokyo, and go into the shopping district, the Ginza district, Shibuya district, and all the various, you know, really big shopping, and just go through these department stores all day. You just go through them, just, you know, it's just like mind-blowing, you know, wow, you know, and it's, now it's more and more, and people are just, you know, thinking, this is it, this is paradise, this is it, that's not what Jesus says, is it? That's not what Jesus says at all. So, I think what I know actually is that almost everyone is ignoring what Jesus is saying, ignoring it, because our heads are too turned by this new world order. So what happened with me is I got great grace and blessing, and I was put through a simulation of what the new world order is going to be like. So I've already lived it, so to speak, and I've already realized this isn't it. And so then I've been able to really focus in on what is it. If I hadn't have done that, I'd have my head being turned right now. So the reason why I'm able to do right now is I've already been through it. It's like I was taken into the future, so to speak, and sort of simulated the future. What is it going to be like? And then acted as if I was living there. And then I realized, wow, you know, this is empty. This isn't it at all. It's just boring, essentially. And you say, wow, I haven't really even touched upon, you know, what my true inheritance is. My true inheritance. I'm not bound by anything. No one is bound. There's no boundness whatsoever. And this ersatz fake, you know, well, I'm not bound by either being a male or a female. I can be both. And, well, you're bound by both then. You know, what gain is that? You know. People do all these body modifications. I can change my form, make my form, you know, different stuff. I'll turn into Tiger Woman or something, or Superman, you know. Okay, that's all. As Jesus said, it's a masquerade. You play all these roles. Okay, fine. Just realize that none of this has the slightest thing to do with what you are, with reality, what your freedom is, really. You think you're pretending to be bound by all this stuff. No one's bound by any of it. But again, the reason why there's not so many people really bringing it, the truth, is because their heads are getting turned at this time. Their heads are getting turned, for sure. They're starting to say, wow, you know, look at all this, the merchandise. I just was here, you know, 8 weeks ago, and there's completely new merchandise everywhere. I'm in Bed Bath & Beyond, everything's different. They keep changing it. It's like, wow, that'd be kind of cool to have this, or cool to have that, you know. Everybody's looking more and more glamorous, you know, and healthy and smart, you know, just thinking, wow. You know, so their heads are getting turned. Better to stay out of stores, actually. If you're a real music junkie or some sort of junkie, wow, look out. Because you'll say, oh, I'll get to Jesus soon, for sure. I just want to listen to this playlist or something. I was just starting listening to the inspirational song playlist I have on my channel here. But Holy Spirit said, don't put the headphones on, so I didn't. So I just had the headphones sitting on the desk, and I could hear a little bit of stuff from them. And then I started listening to the second song and the third song. I said, no, forget it. Stop. I'm going to do this taping. I'm not going to listen to it. So you see, that's the difference. The difference is who has the capacity now to keep bringing the intensity, bringing the good news. And it is undistracted. The problem is almost everybody's distracted now. So very few are listening. Those who are, very good, very great, actually, very great. It's the discipline that is needed. So you're doing what is needed, the discipline of hearing, trying to hear deeper and deeper and deeper, which is what I say causes the burn. When you really hear, it's like an earthquake in you. You're just like, whoa, wow, that's a game changer. Feels like the landscape is suddenly all shifted on you. And this is then full stop in this burn. It's an ordeal to remain poised and calm and just get used to this new landscape, because you've just moved closer, you know, to perfection. And you're seeing it now, and it's in a much more clear way. You just say, oh my gosh, look, it's fantastic, it's wonderful. This is the path, this is the discipline that's necessary, moving our comfort zone. We are perfect. Everything is perfect right now. Absolute perfection is the truth of everything, of all, right now. That's God. So we're getting closer and closer and closer to accepting this. But we're so used to believing we've changed perfection, and therefore perfection doesn't exist at all anymore. Once you change perfection, it's not perfection at all. It doesn't exist at all. So everything is completely changed. It's a whole different like scenario. And we're so used to that, that perfection just, you know, throws us for a loop. Continuity fear, we just say, wait a minute, you know, where are my bearings? How do I get oriented in perfection? We're used to this dream of imperfection. So we have to gradually get used to this, gradually get used to it. And this song's music really doesn't do that, is the problem. It really doesn't do that. Sitting quietly does. So the amazing thing here I'm a complete musical junkie. I was a complete 100% musical junkie who basically never was not listening to music, who just had an insatiable appetite for music of all types, the very finest I could find, complete connoisseur and junkie. And here I am not listening to it at all. And here I am in the age where it's all available at the touch of, free for, you know, touch of a finger, click of a mouse, for free. Like YouTube, well, it's all free on YouTube. And for very little expense on other, you know, other venues. Some of the, you know, newer music that people are charging for. But it's all available. All available. It's a music junkie's paradise here. And what am I doing? I'm not listening to any of it. It's like kicking heroin. You know, I was able to like kick heroin, the music heroin. I was able to kick the habit of music heroin junkieism. That is not easy to do. And of course, those who don't do it rationalize it and say, no, it's good. I don't need to. That's because they don't think they can do it. If you don't think you can do something, of course you're going to rationalize it and say, it doesn't need to be done. The reason I'm not doing it is it doesn't need to be done. I don't need to do that. That's the reason. I could do it if I wanted to. I just don't need to. This is rationalization. What we all must do is the vision of oneness. And all we need to do is just hold on to that, and that cures all problems. There's nothing else we need to do. Beautiful, beautiful day to day. Ridiculous, another ridiculous day in California. It's just, and then this evening is just beautiful, super clear, warm, calm. It's like awesome, the trees, with all the trees that are turning colorful everywhere, everything's just crystal clear and colorful. I just say, okay, well, yeah, but, and then again, I also was a climate junkie, you know, as far as good weather, I was aficionado of like great weather and great scenery and stuff, and so California is like ideal, you know, this is like, you know, the ideal place that I had in mind, like for a dualistic paradise. The Bay Area of California, with all this music, you know, and all the different cosmopolitan people, you know, people, and all this stuff. And so, that's where I ended up. That's where I ended up. Now, Jesus tells us that our circumstances are a direct reflection of what it is we've desired. Well, that is true, but I would say, with a very important caveat there, we desiring this because of our continuity fear. It's not because we really want it at all, you know. So it's not what we really want. There's a difference there. It's what we think we want. But we're desiring it. We're experiencing what we desire to experience. So, but our continuity fear has us think that, oh, this is it. So this is, okay, this is what I want. This is what we get. So our experience does reflect our desire, but we're desiring to believe that we're bound, you know, so, and then to try to find a paradise within this bondage. So that's what we're experiencing. And I've tried to get the very best of that, you know, and the, you know, what many people think, that feel the Bay Area of California is the best place on earth. All, if you take everything into account, and they're probably right about that. But it's hell. It's absolute hell here, actually. See, so then where do you go? You know, that's what I'm thinking, like, wow, you know, what's the answer, God? Even the very best situation I could imagine and think, you know, it's still total hell. Miserable, miserable, miserable. And the existential problems I'm in right now are getting worse and worse and worse and worse and worse, and the news is horrific. And so here I am in this like beautiful crystalline day, and you know, in the best place in the world with all this music available and beautiful people, and here I am just like shaking and trembling and in fear, you know, of the future, not being able to function going forward. And so it's just terrible. Oh, and by the way, if you're a literary junkie, you have all these books at your disposal, right? The entire library of the world is at your disposal. That's another one if you're really into that. And I was. So there's another hook. Love to read, you love to literature, love to read. Now you can read anything. And isn't it interesting that I don't read anything anymore, except for a couple of key spiritual books, Journey Beyond Words and Spaciousness by Keith Dalman. The Words of Longchenpa, translated by Keith Dalman, translated, yeah. Dharmadhatu, a treasury of Longchenpa or something. Spaciousness, the radical Dzogchen of the Vajra heart, something like that. And A Course in Miracles also, occasionally I open that up too. But I don't read the magazines, I don't read anything. And then you got all this stuff going on the internet, you know. I don't go to any places really, hardly at all. I go to YouTube and maybe sports news. And that's it. That's it. Yeah, we have this just like almost infinite like variety of stuff that you could be into if you're interested. I don't do any of it. It's just no interest, waste of time. So this so-called paradise of this world for me is hell. Absolute hell. I'm bored to death here. I mean, you can sit down and you can order chocolate from all over the world, right? Dial in any chocolate. If you're a coffee, you can dial in any coffee and you can order it from any place in the world. Customize your diet. Customize your gourmetness. Not interested. So basically, this world is useless to me. It's useless. I don't find any use to. Or you can travel anywhere you want if you have the money. You can really, right? You can take trek anywhere in this planet and go anywhere, basically, right now. Huh? Useless. Useless. Don't have the money to do it, you can't do it. And even if you did, you know, so what? After a while, you just say, wow, this isn't the answer. This isn't the answer. So for me, the world is really non-essential. I don't need it. It doesn't serve any purpose for me. If someone says, hey, here's some music, you gotta listen. Nah, forget it. No. I've done enough listening to music. I don't need to listen to that. Forget it. And if the people who are into decadence, okay, they can dial up any kind of decadence they want, right? Go on Craigslist or search the internet or something. You can hook up culture. You know, anything goes in the world right now. So it's just this materialist, sensual materialist paradise in this world right now. And for me, again, the world's like this. It's nothing. It's like a piece of mud, basically. A piece of dirt. You can make videos of anything. You can take video cameras. You can make be an auteur, you know, movie maker. And I've already done that. Actually, I did that. I used to have a really good digital Sony cameras. There's the call. So I don't know if people realize what's happened in this world. But spirit, and you can search for all sorts of spiritual stuff too, right, if you want. But it's like people are looking at it like just another part of accessory, like another part of all the other stuff that they're doing. And they're wallowing in this, you know, paradise. Like, wow, we've just got to embrace it, sink our teeth into it. This is like incredible. No, this is the trap. This is the trap. This is what pulls you into another cycle. There's a extreme price to pay for this. And what is the price to pay? Is you start getting bored of it all. And because of the continuity fear, you feel you can't let go of it. So you have to frantically work to keep generating more and more interest in it, more and more interest, more and more fashion, more and more weirdness, you know, more and more. You become frantic and frantic to keep it going so you can keep participating in it so you don't feel bored out of your mind. Say, hey, wait a minute, this isn't it for me. They say, well, what do I do then? Oh, gosh, I have no clue. You let people say, oh, my gosh, yeah, I'll be annihilated or something. So the trap is you have to keep it all going. This is a very bad trap, isn't it? And back to the camera, I had a couple of very good digital cameras with the manual, all sorts of manual controls. And I went out around making beautiful nature videos and stuff. It was just amazing. I mean, just better than anything on YouTube. It's definitely YouTube. I'm very disappointed about the quality of what people have done, really. I mean, I really had some very artistically beautiful videos. It's just like with waterfalls and streams and just gorgeous stuff. But I destroyed it all. You know, I threw it all into a dumpster one day. Everything. And the cameras finally broke, right? And so I couldn't keep doing it. They had blur, you know, it was just, and it's just amazing that you can make some very beautiful videos. But okay, so anyone can do that. Anyone can go around and do all sorts of creative stuff, you know, seemingly in this world. But been there, done that, it gets boring. Had a recording studio, could record anything I wanted to record, to do so much stuff on synthesizers and sounds and beats and everything. Threw all that away too. Threw it all away. There's a few songs that I kept, but the experimentation I did was very, very amazing. It kind of blew my mind for a long time, just what you could do. Then after a while, I said, wow, burned out, forget it. Then what do you do, right? So those who keep wallowing in it and not really listening to spiritual truth, not hearing it, they'll get caught up in trying to having to keep it going. Fear starts gripping them. I need more, I need more, I need more, I need more, I need more. It's not enough. I need a new car. I need a new this, I need a new that. Gotta keep being stimulated and distracted, and it's horrible, 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 horrible. You start getting weird mental problems, and then you start needing medication for that. Then you start having side effects, you need more medication for that. You might have trouble sleeping. You might develop stress diseases. Doctors saying they're seeing the young people now with old people, like osteoarthritis and things like that. Rheumatoid arthritis, all sorts of weird, problems that older people usually have, stress-based. So it is indeed a very challenging situation here, which is the remedy is to hear the truth, practice hearing it. There's no other remedy because we have a continuity problem. It is not solved by a pill or by material things, nor by intellectual calculation or mathematical calculation, twisting a phrase or poetry. It is not solved by any of that. The continuity fear is solved through gradually deepening your hearing of the good news. This is it. There's no other way. Which is why the great teachers tell us you must practice every day, and you must increase your practice. You must keep doing it, year after year after year. Keep doing it. It's the only way. Because it's a continuity issue. We're talking about perfection. This is something we thought we left behind for good long, long ago. We believe we've distanced ourselves. It's gone. It's vanished. It's disappeared. It's no more. We never even have to think about perfection anymore. Well, guess what? It didn't go anywhere. And neither did we go anywhere. Perfection is still perfect. Perfection still is. There's no escaping perfection. And so, in our beliefs, we believe we've escaped it. Or it's gone. It's gone. No. So, we have this continuity issue then. There's no way around it. No way around it. And all the efforts we spend to find a way around it, we're just wasting time. And if we spent those efforts actually practicing our hearing, deepening our hearing, we would succeed. So basically what we do in this world is, as far as distractions, is to find out this isn't it, this isn't it, this isn't it, this isn't it. Well, go as fast as you can in that. Don't get stuck. It's difficult. I had a difficult time for sure. Hated to get rid of everything, but ended up having to get rid of everything that I had. But it helped, what helped me get unstuck was not stuck in any of it. So now it's just like super simple, just a simple cheap camera, a couple lights, and upload to YouTube. That's it. That's the extent of my gadgetry, really. I had to get a case for my flip phone today, and they actually had one. It sort of fits all, slim phones or whatever. I mean, flip phones of various stuff. So mine barely fits in there, but it fits. Surprised they had it. They said, well, we just have one, just have one of these, and got about 1,000 for the smartphones and stuff. But again, the smartphones are part of this whole materialistic culture that we believe is paradise, and so many of us have been hooked into this coming here now. And we may think, well, we're here, we might as well just indulge in it all. No. It's like going to a party and they have all this booze, and you say, well, this booze is here, I might as well indulge in it all or something. No. Because again, we end up being trapped into it, having to keep it all going and improving upon it, making it more intense. It eats you up, devours you. Remember, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. See all as this endless, golden, shimmering, glimmering, beautiful golden light, unbounded, blissful, free. This is what we are. This is our identity. This is our identity. This body has nothing to do with our identity. Nobody has anything to do with our identity. Nobody is us. No one is us. Nobody is us. Nobody is nobody. Nobody is nobody. So these bodies, you see, have nothing to do with what we are. And we're just trying to get past this, you know, bodies. Can we not just see past this, God? This is my prayer. I've been praying and praying this for a long time. And some, you see some bodies say, oh, wow, that they look like really wonderful person or something. Remember, all our reactions to bodies, we're imagining our own death, Because something we believe that we need to make ourselves happy will certainly pass away. And there's a feeling then that perfection isn't perfect. Perfection isn't perfect, which is imagine that we're dead to perfection. And that we're determinate, which means we're a form, which means we're process-based, which means we're belong in this world where everything falls apart, ceaselessly falls apart. Terrible dream of determinism. So Jesus always says, extend it to everyone, extend freedom to everyone without exception. If you make an exception, it won't work at all. So we have to say, well, maybe if it's not working, I'm making an exception. I don't know what exception I'm making, but you know, must be in some way. Maybe you see somebody you think completes you, makes you happy, you refuse to see them as not a body. You know, that's very possible, right? If you have a special relationship with anything, if you're valuing anything, you refuse to see that as indeterminate. You'll see it as a form, as determinate, as conditioned existence, something you think exists. And so you'll be bound to that appearance, thinking that you need that appearance to be complete, to be happy. Whereas what I said is the very structure, nature of reality is happiness, is bliss, inescapable. It's not appearance related at all. Feeling something, wow, fatigue or something like that, stress. Another thing people are, they're health junkies as far as, they think they can make themselves super healthy now. They got all these vitamins, all these products, all these steroids, all these this and that, whatever. And also people are like medical procedure junkies. Oh, I could get all these medical procedures on me. You know, that's like super cool. Or, you know, body modification junkies or something. It goes on and on and on and on and on, doesn't it? Basically, you can be a junkie any way you want to in this world right now. It's a world full of junkies, really. You can be a control freak, too. It's a great time if you want to be a control freak, to be in this world. A lot of people like being control freaks, and they're all here now in this world, aren't they? Trying to tell us what to think, what we need to do. What we need to be, what we need to look like, what's determining for us, what our determinancy needs to be like. Of course, we don't have any determinancy at all. No one does. So Jesus' intention is to save us from all this nonsense, which is really just a waste of time. We won't get anything out of it, actually. I mean, we're eating like royalty now, really. Better than royalty ever ate. Fresh this, fresh this, fresh this. Go to the market, get it, cook it up this evening. Top it off with, you know, vast variety of desserts or whatever, you know, it just goes on and on. And if you're a drug addict, you can get, if you're a drug junkie, you get so many different drugs in this world, designer drugs of every type. Some states now you can go in and legally get all different varieties of ganja, you know, from anywhere in the world. You become a connoisseur of ganja junkie. So this is like, this life is your oyster, you know, life is this world's your oyster. You eat, and oh, oops, I got gout, you know, I got gout. Too many lobster rolls or something. What a bummer, I can't walk, I got gout. Or I'm gaining weight, what a bummer, I'm gaining too much weight. You think you can indulge, but stuff starts happening. I used to go love the ocean and swimming. Just absolutely couldn't get enough of that. Okay, it's the ocean there, I'm out there. And surfing and body surfing. Used to body surf a lot too. Terry talk about intense. Then my ears went bad and trapped water in my ears. I haven't been in the water since. Haven't, you know, swam for, except for one time for what, 35 years maybe. So something I love to do, almost everything I love to do, I'm not able to do it. That's amazing. Crazy. And the places that I hate to go, I end up there all the time now. Place I want to go, can't go there. It's just, you know, bizarre. Bizarre world here. So we need a breakthrough real fast. Need a real, you know, more and more epiphanies, more and more breakthroughs. Most people are willing to sell their soul for all this. What does soul mean? Momentum. Spiritual discernment. Soul means spiritual discernment and the momentum that it produces towards realization. Of a vision of oneness, that I am not a body, I am free. Nothing has ever happened. So the momentum towards that is what we call soul, is the spiritual discernment. Most people are willing to sell their spiritual discernment for all this stuff. You know, pigs, we're all pigs here, basically. And we're all putting different lipstick on, you know, look at my lipstick today. Someone else says, wow, this is really cool lipstick. Yeah, look at mine, look at mine. Good. So, wow, that's great. How'd you get that gloss on your snout, you know? Well, this new compound, yeah, the laboratory just came out, this incredible compound, you know? Oh, yeah. Botox my, you know, our snouts, get our beaks fixed. So we're all looking at each other saying, wow, what glossy, yeah, that's glossy, nice glossy stuff. Thinking this is it, because we've sold the devil, so to speak. Really sold our soul to the devil of this really big business alliance that's at play here in this world now. I mean, the cosmos is at play to that. And not having spiritual discernment, where do you go? Start getting pretty, you know, weird when that happens. You know, pretty soon there'll be the designer industry for euthanasia, you know, or assisted suicide, or what was it called? End of life quality. Now they're calling it or something. They're calling suicide end of life quality. You know, we keep having to invent more and more euphemisms for our, you know, for hell. And they'll be, you know, designer ways. People be really into, you know what, I think it's time to make my transition. And there'll be like elaborate, you know, ceremonies and stuff. And design, and everybody be like aficionados. What kind of combination of drugs, what kind of experience do I want to have, you know, when I'm dying, you know, making the transition. And you think I'm getting old now. I think it's time to make the transition. It gets into all of that. It gets into this weird, weird bizarreness. And of course, everybody rationalizes and say, no, this is it. This is great. This is progress. This is what we need. And religion's changing very fast. This Pope Francis is changing everything as fast as he possibly can to fit in with the New World Order, to fit in. Got to keep the institution flag flying, you know. Putting mammon in the head of God. Really? Getting in bed with the devil. Really? Jesus says, hey, I don't see any of you as bodies at all. And he says, I also don't see myself as a body because I give you the freedom to be what you truly are. He says, I also give myself the freedom. So I don't, Jesus says, I don't see myself as a body at all. This is golden light, this shines into eternity, endlessly. Yeah. It's incredibly beautiful. He says, that's how I see myself. That's how Jesus sees himself. And people are trying to make a gender-free body. What a waste of time, you know. That's not how Jesus sees himself. He doesn't see himself as some transgender, hermaphrodite, you know, new world order, new race body or something. He said, I do not see myself as a body at all. I see myself as this golden light. Hey, this is gospel. This is good news. This is what we need to be hearing, is the gospel. And it has to be a very spot-on gospel right now because of the allure of this world. You know, the old gospel of, hey, you know, I'm saved by Jesus, I feel wonderful, and thank you, Lord. You know, the evangelical stuff, you know, you hear it on some of these songs. Okay, that's great, but we need the good news that is really spot-on right now. Very intense, very spot-on because of the allure of this new world order. Some people call this the satanic kingdom, actually. I call it really big business. It's not really big business alliance, or a really big business alliance, actually. They have reasons for this, you know. Keep everybody drunk on, you know, bread and circuses and steal all the resources of the planet. Plunder the planet till it's just a shell. And whoops, need to go somewhere else, folks. What happened to your world? Oh, gee. Slag pile, you know. Landfill. So. Yeah, there's so many ways now with all this tight technology to just distract yourself. Distract yourself, you know. Custom design your children, how they're going to look, you know. And they'll be into that, you know, for sure. All this stuff is coming. I mean, what's coming is just a bizarre circus, really. Circus of the bizarre. And yet, so many people are like, just, they're like moths to a flame. They can't resist. They cannot resist. It doesn't really speak to the truth at all, doesn't it? It doesn't help us. It doesn't liberate us from delusion at all. It doesn't help us realize that there's never been any even instant of existence. Never will be. All is inherently perfect. Reality's never been changed, can never be changed. We are spirit. We are all one. Isness is. And always is. I am still spirit as God created me. It does not speak to that at all. It does not speak to that at all. It just basically compounds the continuity problem. Compounds it. So, although we may say, well, thank God for the Hinsons, as the song goes, thank God for the Cooks, and thank God for the Hinsons, a couple of really great gospel groups. No, thank God for Jesus. Thank God for Longchampa. Thank God for the great saviors, teachers, the reminders, the great reminders and encouragers of reality to spirit that is lost in this masquerade, an unnecessary masquerade. Thinking that somehow this is part of what we are, like we're part spirit and part flesh. No, we're not. We're 100% spirit. They think we're part human and part divine. No, we're not. We're 100% divine. 100% divine. We're 100% divine. Always have been. We need something now as we go towards the Christmas season. Why do we have this season? Because this is the birth of Christ, at least the nominal celebrated birth of it, but it symbolizes it. It's a reminder of it. Christmas. All right. Nobody's saying that now. It's all holiday season. When's the last time you said, hey, someone said, hey, get ready for Christmas? No, or Christmas season? Or no, holiday season. Holiday season. The holidays. It's the holidays. But of course, Christmas means the holidays. I mean, sure, but it points out, you know, what the central relevance of the holidays are. I know there's also other traditions that have their traditions too, which is fine, of course. But overall, Christmas has been, you know, that's very important. Maybe they'll start calling Easter Holy Week. They'll call it Spring Break or something. Yeah, we're gonna time for Spring Break. It's not Holy Week or Easter anymore. It's Spring Break. Okay. Now, it does relate to a specific religion, but the message is universal for all of us. That is, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. Jesus showed us he's not a body. Even though he had this body, animated this body moving around, he said, okay, kill the body, and I'll still have an appearance here. See, it's just an appearance. I am not the body. can't kill me, I'm spirit. This is universal. This is universal teaching. So Easter is a really universal celebration of the resurrection, actually. Crucifixion, resurrection, that whole situation, which showed us what's what, that is for sure. I said, wow, death is an imposture. We need to set death down. Death isn't real. Death is not real. It's not real. It's unreal. Death is unreal. So, again, what is the really big business? What's their business? Producing good citizens. What's the business of Jesus and all of Jesus' friends in truth? Producing saints. That's his business. So he means to succeed in his business. Jesus, you are to be a saint. You are to be a saint. You are to do what he did, set death down. Absolutely. You realize you're free of death. I've always been free of it. Never died, never been born. And keep hearing. You're on the road to sainthood. You're on the road to sainthood. Not citizenhood, but sainthood. Okay, citizenhood has to bow to sainthood, not the other way around. And really big business says, no, sainthood has to bow to citizenhood. And we say, no. Which is why Jesus may have prepared a place for those who are on the path to sainthood. And it's possible we may go there. It's possible. Because I'm certainly not going to bow to citizenhood. There's all these laws now, so you have to have health care, you have to this. I don't want health care. I'm going to set down some sickness, I'm going to set down death. You know, not going to need it at all. So, but you got to be a good citizen, you have to have it? No. You have to recognize sainthood. See, but it's not being recognized in this world. It is absolutely not. It's like some sort of archaic myth now. To the way the world is looking at stuff. So, thank God for the, thank God for the saints, thank God for Jesus. Now, if you're lapsing back into music junkie habit, try listening to some inspirational music. It's a different flavor. You know, it doesn't pull you down so badly. It doesn't pull you down so badly. You know, musically speaking, you know, it's not sophisticated. You know, it's not sophisticated, but it's something to it. There's some authenticity to it. You know, that you feel. You know, there is some orientation there. There is some knowledge, realization. You know, I need to be a saint. I need to be a saint. I need to be like Jesus. I need to be like Jesus. We need to be like Jesus. The good news is we already are like Jesus. In fact, we are all Jesus. We all are spirit, which is what Jesus is. We all are that golden light as Jesus sees us. We are not a body. None of us are bodies. We're all free. We're all still spirit, exactly as God created us to be. Keep hearing this, keep hearing it. We wonder, well, how come I'm not? We have to keep hearing it and get more and more used to it, more and more ready. And then the epiphanies will come, the clarity will come. I pray that a clarity comes this evening for me. So, but I'm just making the effort here, which is what I suggest everyone does. And maybe these videos will help you, you know, get into it. Realize you got to get into it and do it. But it's not that easy just to, you know, do it yourself and decide, I'm just going to sit down, I'm going to do it. It's not that easy. That's true. So we're told we're living in paradise, and yet we're suffering like crazy. And I think, wow, this is scary. If this is paradise, then I'm in trouble because I don't feel so good. So for me, I got desperate And one timeline is desperate for me, so I have to shift, quote unquote. One destiny path is ruination. The other, so I got to shift destiny paths for sure. I got to say no to the world. You know, all this junkieism. You know, I don't want to be an addict anymore. We're all addicts. This world's a world of addicts now. Everybody's getting more and more addicted to all sorts of stuff. So how do we shift our destiny path? Well, I'm trying to help in this way. Remember, the key is to, in order to fix what's wrong, simply hold on to what's right. That automatically takes care of it. Automatically takes care of it. Nothing else needs to be done. Just hold on to reality, and that fixes all untruth, all lies, all deceptions, all illusions, all mirages. Just hold on to reality. Keep hearing this and keep moving your comfort zone towards that. Hold on to everything. Everything's right here, right now, actually. There's no place at all, nowhere at all, where everything is not present always. The form of reality is this so-called emptiness, which is the form of everything, actually. So nothing in particular is standing out, right? The perfect void is actually the form of everything. And so that form of everything is everywhere. And then we pull out of that whatever experiencing we want. It's pure potentiality. It's always there. So everything, all, as Marie Watts said, all in all. The God is all in all. All in all. She said it's very important. Marie Watts, one of the few saint-like saints in America, American history. Funny thing, there's no picture of her at all. There's no photograph. Well, I haven't been able to find one single photograph of Marie Watts. It's like she doesn't have a body. She was never here, and if the body or something, you know? It's amazing. So, I have no idea what Marie Watts, or what the physical appearance was at all. That's quite extraordinary, quite extraordinary. But she was spot on in a lot of ways. Vernacular is a little bit dated, you know, right? But so, and we're struggling now with this really big alliance, which is, you know, really, you know, people, if you realize this, you gotta step up on everything. I mean, you're very blessed to realize this. Explain so much of what's happening here. Explain so much. And then you realize you have to step up your game. You realize the game has changed here in this world. You have to step up your game, which is what we're doing here. See, we're bringing it here. We're bringing it. We're bringing Longchenpa, okay? We're bringing Jesus Christ, you see. We're bringing Ramana Maharshi. We're bringing Ananda Mahima. We're stepping it up here because we have to. Because the world has stepped it up. The really big business alliance has totally stepped it up, right? It's changed the game on this planet. So we have to step up our game too, or else we're toast. So we're bringing in the heavy artillery. When, you know, when you bring in Jesus Christ, a journey beyond words, when you bring in Longchenpa, spaciousness, the radical Dzogchen of the Vajra heart, you're bringing in the heavy artillery for sure. And the really big alliance, the really big business alliance, they can't handle this. They can't handle it. It's too much for them. Too much. It's their kryptonite. While the gospel music is nice, it's not the kryptonite that we need. It's not the kryptonite that we need. See, the people, all these scholars now are pulling apart the Bible and doing all this study, there's so much study of it, you know, and they're starting to say, hey, wait a minute, you know, this isn't the tale we've been told, isn't exactly, you know, it's so nuanced now, actually. And it is true that it's very nuanced. I mean, when it's not just a simple fairy tale, I mean, this is how it happened, da 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 da. When everything got written, who write? Did they write to their audience? Were they trying to appeal to their audience? Who, you know, all these influences, all that is true. It is all true. All that is true. So, if people rely solely on that, they can feel like the landscape is, you know, shifting. Shifting like they're in quicksand, you know, as more and more and more and more and more stuff comes out, people, you know, start believing. A lot of lies have been told too about Jesus. And so historically, you know, when you base something like on historic like that, it gets very slippery. Whereas what we have now is completely abstract. It's not dependent on anything historic. Journey Beyond Words, for instance, it's Jesus right now talking to us. Right now, it's talking to us right now. So we don't need to worry about all those exegesis of, you know, what really happened, and scholars on this side, scholars on that side, all different opinions. Who cares about that? So we have Jesus right now. That's the heavy stuff. That's the heavy artillery we need for this really big business alliance that's, you know, devouring us, devouring our spiritual discernment, turning us into sheeple. So pay attention to the heavy art, heavy stuff. The guru, the heavy stuff. Guru's heavy, you know, to spell their bigness, but need heavy, heavy, really heavy. Heavyweight. We need the heavyweights. We need the heavyweights. Look at Ramana Maharshi, there's a heavyweight. Look at this gaze, look at the gaze, that's heavyweight. That's potent, very potent. You see, that's what I want. Whatever he has is, that's what I want. Meanwhile, the allure builds. The allure builds. The attitudes are shifting. Stuff can crystallize like that in this world. Reach a tipping point, whew, suddenly it happens like that. This is what's coming. This is what's coming. The skids are greased already. The skids are totally greased. There's no resistance to it, no significant resistance in the world. Except people swearing and being angry. That's not significant resistance. Significant resistance is being a saint. Again, the world is not making saints, it's making citizens. Jesus' mission is to make saints. That's Jesus' mission for the world. That's Jesus' purpose for the world, is to make saints. And that's what we're about. That's our goal. That's our path. And we shall succeed. We shall succeed. Waste your time on anything else. If they're not bringing the heavy stuff, don't waste your time. Don't waste your time. Don't waste your time. Get the heavy stuff now. Get it now. Get it now. Get used to it. Get used to it. Get used to it. Get used to it. Don't worry about this or this or that or that or that. Just keep hearing. Get used to it. Get used to it. Get used to it. It's like if you're going to a different climate. You can study all the books you want about it, and you have a library full. But you're not there. You're not getting used to it. So when you go to that climate, you say, "Oh my gosh, I'm not used to it." But I know I've read a million books about the difference in climate, you know. The thing to do is go there and start getting used to it. Stop, you know, worrying about this and this and that particulars. And this, you know, blah blah blah. Go there. Say, wow, this is going to take me quite some time to get used to it. I better stay here and start getting used to it. After a certain amount of time, you say, hey, I'm used to it now. Whereas the other one is still studying and reading books and trying to figure out, okay, what do I need to do when I go there? I got to be expert on getting used to it. I got to be an expert. They hadn't even gone there yet. So when they go there, they need a year to get used to it too, right? And they may quit. They say, I don't have the time for this. I've spent too much time, you know, studying. So, get used to it, get used to it, get used to it. This is the key. Put yourself in the heat. Get the sauna going, the heat. Bring the heat in your practice. It's got to be strong. It's got to be intense. You have to be able to be poised. So we'll try to keep bringing it here. We'll see what we can do. We'll see what we can do. God knows we're doing as much as I can do, it seems like. So, but God will give something more for sure. Always has. Just to make the effort is important. So keep making the effort, keep making the effort. Don't trust the direction of this world. It's a really big business alliance that's running the show in this world. Don't trust it. Take the road to sainthood. Take the road to sainthood. That's it.